Enterprise. Design Lineage. NCC 1701. Commissioned 2245. Production Facility, San Francisco Yards, in Earth Orbit. Class Constitution. Command Robert April, Christopher Pike, and James T. Kirk. Now I've heard of the other two, but Robert April, it's new to me. Service remained in active service until 2284 when it was assigned to training duty at Starfleet Academy. Destroyed in 2285 while defending the Mutara sector against a Klingon incursion. NCC 1701A. Commission 2286. Same thing, San Francisco Yards, Constitution Class, Command James T. Kirk. Originally named Yorktown, was redesigned Enterprise and assigned to the command of Captain Kirk after he and his crew saved Earth from the effects of an alien spacecraft. Played a vital role in the success of the Kittimer Conference, which had a profound impact on the political climate of this part of the galaxy. 1701B. Commission Data unavailable. Production Facility Antares Shipyards. Command Data unavailable. Service key figure in exploration of space beyond the Garami sector. Responsible for mapping over 142 star systems, including first contact with 17 civilizations. 1701C. Commission Data unavailable. Production Facility Earth Station McKinley. Class Ambassador. Command Rachel Garrett. Service. Destroyed in 2344 near the Narendra system while defending a Klingon outpost from Romulan attackers. This was a crucial step leading to the alliance between the Federation and the Klingon Empire. And the 1701D, which is our next generation vessel. Commissioned in 2363. Production Facility Utopia Planitia Yards in Mars orbit. Class Galaxy. Command Jean-Luc Picard. Service already distinguished itself in a number of significant missions of exploration, as well as in several crucial incidents defending the security of the Federation. Senior Officers, Jean-Luc Picard. Post, Captain. Rank, Captain. Service, Captain on USS Stargazer. Education, distinguished himself at Starfleet Academy as an excellent shuttle pilot. Birthplace, Labar, France, on continental Europe, Earth. Medical history, artificial heart. Interests, fencing, horseback, riding, and Shakespeare. William T. Riker. Post, First Officer. Rank, Commander. Birthplace, Valdez, Alaska, on continental North America, Earth. Interests, cooking, jazz and blues, poker. Doesn't really tell you much about, you know, their history and stuff. Beverly Crusher. Post, Chief Medical Officer. Rank, Commander. Service, Head of Starfleet Medical for 1 year. Relatives in Starfleet. Widow of Starfleet Officer Jack Crusher. Mother of Wesley Crusher, Starfleet Academy student. Interests, amateur theater and dancing. Data. Post, Operations Manager. Really? Rank, Lieutenant Commander. Birthplace, Android created by Dr. Noonien Sung, discovered at the Omicron Theta Colony Remains. Interests, classical, chamber music, painting, and Sherlock Holmes. True that. Deanna Troy. Post, Ship's Counselor. Rank, Lieutenant Commander. Education, Psychology major at the University of Beta Zed. Birthplace, Beta Zed in 2336 to parents Betazoid Loxana Troy and Starfleet Officer Ian Andrew Troy. Betazoid heritage gives her limited empathic abilities. Geordi LaForge. Post, Chief Engineer. Rank, Lieutenant Commander. Medical history, bioelectronic vision device, visor, allows him to see entire electromagnetic spectrum. Interests, shipbuilding. and Worf. Post, Chief Security Officer. Rank, Lieutenant. Service, first Klingon to serve aboard a Starfleet vessel. Birthplace, adopted by human parents Sergei and Helena Rozenko. Raised on a planet Galt. I believe it's Rozenko, I believe. Interests, holodeck exercise, Parisi squares, and poetry reading. Okay, structure of the Enterprise. Space frame. The primary space frame is fabricated from an interlocking series of tritanium and duranium macrofilament truss frames. Mounted to the primary space frame is a secondary frame of micro-extruded terminium trusses to which the inner hull structure is directly attached. This basic mechanical framework provides physical integrity to the craft while at rest. Hull layers. The exterior shell consists of multiple layers which afford structural and atmospheric integrity for the space frame. Internal waveguides and field conductive members for the structural integrity field, SIF, and pathways for other utilities, as well as resistance to radiation. Oh, there's that SIF. Structural integrity field. The mechanical integrity of the physical space frame is augmented by the structural integrity field, SIF, system, which provides a network of force field segments that compensate for load factors that otherwise exceed the design limits of the space frame. Force field energy is applied directly to field conductive elements within the frame. Three field generators exist on deck 11 for the primary hull, and two exist on deck 32 for the secondary hull. Cruise mode operation requires at least one field generator to be active at all times in each hull, although a second generator may be activated for extreme maneuvers. IDF. The inertial damping field, IDF system, generates a controlled series of variable symmetry force fields that serve to absorb the inertial forces of spaceflight which would otherwise cause fatal injury to the crew. Flux generation for the IDF is provided by four field generators located on deck 11 in the primary hull and by two generators located on deck 32 in the engineering hull. Cruise mode operation requires at least two field generators to be active at all times in each hull, although additional units may be activated for extreme maneuvers. Okay, systems. Oh, yeah, a lot of reading. Command. Oh my. And under this main bridge, primary operational control of the Enterprise is provided by the main bridge, located at the top of the saucer module on deck 1. It directly supervises all primary mission operations and coordinates all departmental activities. Due to the critical nature of the bridge systems in extreme situations, the main bridge receives priority life support from two special systems. Bridge operations. The main bridge is directly responsible for supervising all primary mission functions and, via the ops manager, for monitoring all secondary mission functions. It also serves as a command center during alert and crisis situations. Cruise mode, the normal operating status, requires a minimal bridge staff of commanding officer, usually the captain, flight control officer, operations manager, and at least one other officer to serve at the tactical or other stations as required. During yellow alert, all active bridge stations are fully enabled and diagnostics run on all primary and tactical systems. Ops curtails all activities that may hamper ship emergency preparedness. During red alert, all bridge stations, are fully enabled. Tactical systems are placed on full alert and the security chief mans the tactical station. Flight control console. Often called the CON, the operator oversees the actual piloting and navigation of the ship. Major responsibilities of the flight control officer are course plotting, supervision of automatic flight operations, manual flight operations, position verification, and liaison with engineering. (Clears throat) Ops. It is the responsibility of operation management, or ops, to schedule resources or hardware, like power or the use of sensors, that affect numerous departments so as not to jeopardize mission goals. Mission ops aids ops in monitoring secondary mission activity and serving as relief. Tactical Station. The tactical station, located directly behind the command stations for an unobstructed view of the main screen, is responsible for defensive systems including shields, phasers, photon torpedoes, and internal security, including armory inventory, security team assignments, and security of ambassadors or other visiting dignitaries. Other duties include command of sensor arrays, sensor probes, message buoys, tractor beams, as well as coordinating with CON and ops in all situations involving external hazards. Command stations. Centrally located to maximize interaction with bridge personnel and provide an unobstructed view of the main screen, these stations are occupied by the commanding officer, usually the captain, and two others, typically the first officer and the counselor. The captain's chair incorporates miniature status displays in its armrests as well as simplified CON and ops controls, which, in emergency situations, can be used to control the basic operation of the ship. The other two positions include larger displays permitting these officers to access and manipulate data as their duties require. Science stations. Located on the main bridge upper level behind the tactical station, these two stations are available for use as needed to provide real-time scientific data, provide access to sensors for command intelligence and to support ops, act as a command post for coordinating activities of science labs and other departments, monitor secondary mission status, and reconfigure and recalibrate sensor systems at short notice for specific requirements. Mission Ops. Located on the main bridge directly behind the tactical station, this post is used for specifically for monitoring activity related to secondary missions and primary away team missions. Environment Station. Although often unattended, this station is of crucial importance during alert situations. It allows monitoring and control of all the life support systems aboard the Enterprise. While unattended, this station will inform ops of any situation requiring human intervention. Engineering Station. This station duplicates, in simplified form, the primary status displays from main engineering. It provides the chief engineer or other senior staff with the ability to monitor and control virtually all engineering systems while maintaining a presence on the bridge. And the Battle Bridge. The Battle Bridge sits on Deck 8 at the top of the battle section. It serves as a command and control center for tactical operations during separated flight mode and as an auxiliary control center. Primary station officers include the captain, flight controller, operations manager, and tactical officer. Other dedicated stations include defense systems, engineering, defense communications, computer systems, engagement damage, intelligence, and technology assessment. Alright. So this is systems. Yeah. Computer. Main computer. Cores. The heart of the main computer system is three redundant main processing cores, each of which are able to handle the vessel's primary operational computing requirements. Each core incorporates miniature subspace field generators, which create a symmetrical field distortion within the faster-than-light FTL core elements. This allows optical data to be processed at rates exceeding light speed. Two cores lie between decks 5 and 14 near the center of the primary hull, and the third is between decks 30 and 37 in the engineering hull. Core memory. Main core memory storage consists of 2048 dedicated modules, each with 144 isolinear optical storage chips. Each module can store about 630,000 kiloquads. Average dynamic access under LCAR software control is 4,600 kiloquads per second. That's a lot of freaking kiloquads, man. Subprocessors. Augmenting the main cores is a network of 380 quadratronic optical subprocessors distributed throughout the vessel. Each subprocessor is linked into the optical data network, and most are linked directly to one or more of the main cores. I need a drink. Although not using FTL elements, the network provides an overall system performance improvement. Isolinear optical chips. Cool. Got a picture of them. These chips provide the primary software and data storage medium for the ship. The nanotech devices use single-axis optical crystal layering to reach sub-wavelength switching distances. Onboard nanoprocessors reduce system access time by up to 7% by managing data independent of LCAR's control. When energized by the main core's subspace flux, a 35% increase in processing speed is achieved. PAD. The Personal Access Display Device, PAD, it's an iPad, is a handheld terminal which provides a convenient alternative to using the shipboard control panels. A PAD maintains links with the Enterprise main computers via a subspace transceiver assembly. The control functions mirror those of any multi-layer panel, and theoretically it is possible to fly the Enterprise from one of these devices. Picard sees your iPad. Picard is not impressed. Warp propulsion. Okay, we've seen warp field theory and warp power measurement. So we can look right at warp propulsion system. The single most complex and important part of the Enterprise, the warp propulsion system, WPS, consists of three major components. And that's the extension of a Word perfect file, isn't it? Was that WPF? I'm not sure. It could be just WP. Never mind. The matter-antimatter reaction assembly, power transfer conduits, and warp engine nacelles. The primary application of this system is to propel the ship, but secondary applications include powering, defensive shields, phaser arrays, tractor beams, the main deflector, and computer cores. M/Array, also called the warp reactor, warp engine core, or main engine core, the matter-antimatter reaction assembly, M/Array, provides a million times the power of a standard fusion reactor as used from the impulse propulsion system. This assembly comprises the following subsystems. Reactant injectors, which feed precisely controlled streams of supercooled deuterium and anti-hydrogen fuels into the core. Magnetic constriction segments, which structurally support the reaction chamber, provide a pressure vessel to maintain the proper core operating environment and align incoming matter and antimatter streams. The reaction chamber, which consists of two bell-shaped cavities, contains and redirects the primary reaction. This is pretty complicated words here. Power transfer conduits. Power transfer conduits, PTC, constrain plasma and peristaltically force it from the M/Array towards the warp engine nacelles. I feel like looking up some of these words to see if they're real. Peristaltically? You're looking very peristaltically awesome today. Warp engine nacelles. Plasma created by the matter-antimatter reaction assembly and passed along the power transfer conduits, arrives at the warp engine nacelles where it is injected sequentially into warp field coils along the length of the nacelles to provide the propulsion force for the ship. These are the long sentences. Emergency shutdown. When engine pressure and thermal limits endanger the crew, the computer automatically initiates a shutdown of the warp propulsion system. This procedure involves shutting off plasma to the warp field coils, closing off reactant injectors, and venting remaining gases overboard. In extreme circumstances, it is possible to eject the warp core and antimatter pods to protect the ship. Okay. Impulse propulsion. Impulse propulsion system. Principal sublight propulsion of the ship and certain auxiliary power generation is handled by the Impulse Propulsion System, IPS, which consists of two sets of fusion-powered engines. Normally, the main impulse engine is active, providing propulsion for interplanetary and subspace interstellar flight, but certain operations may require added power from the saucer module engines. Magnetohydrodynamic and electroplasma system TAPS provide an energy for the ship in a shared load arrangement with the warp reaction core. I don't remember words like this when I was reading the computer entries for the final unity. This is insane. Sublight operations are generally restricted to 0.25 Celsius to avoid... I'm not sure if that's Celsius. 0.25C to avoid time dilation effects. That might be... Actually, the C stands for Cochrane. Cochrane units or whatever. Engine configuration. Four individual impulse engines are grouped to form the main impulse engine located on Deck 23. Two groups of two engines comprise the saucer module engines. Each engine each engine comprises the impulse reaction chamber, an armored sphere designed to contain the energy released during nuclear fusion, the accelerator generator, which takes plasma from the reaction chamber, raises its velocity, and passes it on, and the driver coil assembly, which creates the necessary combined field effect as plasma passes through, and the vectored exhaust director, which consists of movable vanes and channels which expel exhaust products in a controlled manner. Oh, we've seen this. Oh no, this is different. Well, this is the impulse system emergency shutdown. Emergency shutdown involves gradually valving off deuterium and safing fusion initiator power regulators, while simultaneously decoupling the accelerator by bleeding residual energy into space. Auxiliary replicators. Overview. Oh my god. Transporter-based molecular synthesis replicators allow almost any inanimate object to be replicated with relatively low energy cost. A phase transition coil chamber dematerializes a measure of raw material into which a matter stream which is modified to conform to a stored pattern matrix. The resulting matter stream passes through waveguide conduits to a replicator terminal and materializes within another phase transition chamber. Food. Food replicators are tuned to accurately replicate the chemical composition of foodstuffs. To minimize power requirements, raw stock for food replicators is stored as sterilized organic particulate suspension, formulated to require the minimum quantum manipulation to replicate into food. The energy cost of food replication is justified by the prohibitive cost of storing food, preparing it, and processing organic waste. Specially modified food replicators exist in sickbay and in science lab for synthesis of pharmaceuticals and scientific supplies. Hardware. Hardware replicators are tuned to a lower resolution than food replicators for greater energy efficiency and lower memory requirements. Certain commonly used spare parts are not economical to replicate and are simply stored as finished products. Critical spares and consumables are also stored for use during alert conditions where replicator power may be unavailable. Alright, tractor beams. Overview. Tractor beam remote manipulators allow direct manipulation of relatively large objects near a starship, such as towing another vessel, modifying the trajectory of a small asteroid, or holding instrumentation at a fixed position relative to the ship. By focusing interference patterns of superimposed subspace graviton force beams generated by the tractor emitters on a remote target, spatial stress is applied to the target. By controlling the focal point and interference patterns, it is possible to use the stress pattern to draw an object towards the ship, or by inverting the interference patterns to push an object. I need another drink. Yeah, we're about an hour in right now. Emitters. The main tractor beam emitters located fore and aft along the engineering hull keel and one forward on the interconnecting dorsal are directly mounted to the ship's framework due to the significant mechanical stress and inertial imbalance created by usage. Done with tractor beams. Holodeck. The holodeck consists of the holographics imagery subsystem, which creates a realistic background environments, and the matter conversion subsystem, which creates physical objects from raw matter supplies. Shaped force fields and background imagery create the illusion of distances apparently larger than the holodeck itself. The environment can be set to scroll or set for bounding limits. The purpose of the holodeck is to maintain the psychological well-being of the crew by allowing them emotional release through interaction with physical objects. Four main holodecks are located on Deck 11. Decks 12 and 13 contain 20 smaller personal holographic simulator rooms. Reaction control system. Low velocity attitude and translational maneuvering is achieved through the use of 6 main and 6 auxiliary reaction control thruster quads. The reaction control system, RCS, is designed for sub-light speed use during station keeping, drift mode 3-axis stabilization, and space dock maneuvering. Navigational deflector. Although interstellar space is virtually free of matter, micrometeoroid particles that do exist pose a real navigational hazard while traveling at relativistic or warp velocities. As a result, the ship incorporates a navigational deflector system, which comprises a powerful tractor deflector beam that sweeps thousands of kilometers in front of the ship, displacing larger objects that may present collision hazards. Okay, communications.